Biola from Ibejuleke, Lagos State of Nigeria. While I was small, I have a passion for myself to become a footballer, a professional footballer. That's all my dreams. 2014, I had injury in my left hand. As you can see, the work I'm doing, even the tiny work I'm doing, I'm just doing it just like for me to feed my family, because I'm the breadwinner of my family. They believe in me. I talked to my friend of mine, he told me to security work. I was like, wow, me security work? Because then I have a BS, I'm looking fresh. I can't do security. It's about my dead body. I tried my possible best, like, this is my passion. It's not going to die like that. And I totally confused what to do right now. That's why I'm sending this video. I'm totally confused what to do. Should I leave my passion and continue working? I don't know what to do.
Hey Biola, how are you doing? I just got your video, and thanks for sending me this video. I don't take it for granted, and I listen to it 7 minutes 40 seconds in it. I listen to every part. There are three things that are important in what I'm going to say to you. The first and most important thing is that you have to learn to survive. You have said a lot of things that your passion is football, but meanwhile, you know, you've injured your hands, and now you don't have it, you don't see it coming the way you should see it. So you have ended up resorting to take a job in security, which you do not like. Now, you doing that security is a job of dignity. First of all, it's a dignity job. You are not unethical, you are making money for yourself. And out of the money you make, your brother, your sister, your family are getting a part. First of all, I salute you. Now, so what you do is that when you have the opportunity, it's not that you should throw your passion away, you can also find out what is happening to your passion. You don't have to always be the one that kicks the ball to be a footballer. Let me use that sense. Sometimes you can even be somebody that is a promoter, somebody that is a journalist in it, somebody that is even an inspiration in football, or even an agent, you know, in that industry. So one of the things you can do is to ask yourself, what other things can you do if you cannot kick the ball to be in the football space? What other things? You know, there are people that are agents, there are people that negotiate matches, there are people that, you know, are able to manage the football things and all that. So you find out all that you can do in that place and now begin to plug yourself. You have an injury on your hand. Consider that, because if you go into the active football, a challenge comes. What is that challenge? The challenge is that if you get injured again, they may have to take out your hand. You don't need that. So what you do is find out what other things can you do in that space. Find out what you can do in that space and then begin to invest 1 hour a day to study how you can, you know, partake in that space. There are a lot of people online, there are scouts online, there are people that do events on football online. Learn what they do and then you can begin to start practicing it. And then also take the opportunity to send messages. Like you sent a message to me, you're getting a response now. Send a message to those people that are doing the kind of things that are in football to show you how they do it, what they do, and then begin to open yourself to it. Yes, you wanted to kick the football. Who knows? Maybe there's another opportunity in you advertising a football match and go and making money from it. So please consider that and make that happy. Yes, I love your dignity. Number two is that you're able to have a passion. Feed your passion with reading magazines, reading new technology. Now, you will see people that are playing footballers, they now have his football also, whereby you don't have to kick the ball, but you are now a digital footballer, something like that. So you need to also consider that as a substitute plan for it and look at it. It's becoming very, very sponsored worldwide right now, eFootball. So you consider that and make that happen to it. So take care. Keep me updated with the decisions that you make and whatever you do. I believe that you can make it happen for yourself. Invest in studying about that industry and what you can do in it. It will go a long way. Thank you very much, Biola, and I see you very soon. Okay, the next question I'm going to have is by AC Dapatem. AC Dapatem says, God bless you, sir. I love listening, you know. My question is, how do you manage a great opportunity but no cash to execute it? For example, you get a big contract, but it's your first time and in business and you don't have the amount of money that is needed for the opportunity. Okay, AC, very, very interesting question. You can become rich by two ways. Number one is by connection, and number two is by operation or passion. When we say connection, we mean that you know somebody who can give you access to the business. That's good. Then the operation is that it is your business. So if you have the contact to get the business, and you have gotten the contract like you said, there are two things you need to do. One is you find partnerships that can help you do the work and share profits, number one, so that you are able to get results. Now, ensure that the legal ownership of the business is you. Ensure that the legal ownership of the business is you, so that you don't make the mistake of going to get a business whereby you now find out that business that you are getting, you are giving it to somebody else to do. There's something they call sliding tackle in Nigerian business. You have the business and then you say, okay, I'm going to give somebody to do it for you and expect that the person is going to give you the money. Wrong. The person gets the money and says he's waiting for them to pay and not pay. Story comes in. So what I would advise is, number one, you have maybe an NDA, a non-disclosure agreement, whereby you agree with terms of with the person. And when you agree terms with the person, you maintain those terms accordingly. You maintain those terms accordingly. So whether the person comes with partnership, you are not owing anybody, you are sharing profits, maybe 50-50 or 60-40, depending on what it is. But make sure that the money comes to your company and then you can now pay that person out. So far it's agreed, document everything. Number two is that you can decide to, source the funding from third party, maybe from a broker or from a company, from a bank or anybody that's ready to, loan you the money at a percentage. But ensure that your percentage is good enough to accommodate the changes. If not, it will not help you. You must ensure that your profit is good. So if you are giving the person 5% or 10% on his money, you ensure that you have at least 25 to 30% profit on it. Otherwise, you'll be working for this other person, which doesn't make sense. That's what you need to do. And when you begin to do that, the third advice I'll give you is begin to create a relationship with a banker. And when I say a banker, someone to the rank of a branch manager, begin to create that relationship before the business comes so that you can do what they call LPO financing, whereby your project document the person can help you source the money through the bank structure and then you can pay. So those are the ways that will help you to do that. And as you are doing, create your systems in place so that you don't have to go back over and over. Plan your cash flow effectively. Because sometimes somebody will give you a project and you get the money, you spend the money, and then the next time you're looking for more money again, plan your cash flow immediately. That will help you do things like that. Yeah. Okay, I have a question from Samuel Logoso. He says, thank you, great leader. Please, video on spirituality in business. Please, effect positive and negative of relationship in building business. Samuel, first of all, thank you for reaching out to me from Togo. Bonjour, bonsoir, wherever you are. Comment ça va? Maybe my French is not too good, but I'm trying. I should have learned more while growing up. So now, that's a very interesting question, positive and negative, especially in the spirituality of business. First of all, understand that money affects people. Money is a very important thing. And your success or your failure, will actually improve you or disappoint or make you feel bad. So there are principles in the Bible, in the Quran, in whatever faith you have. You need to identify what are the values that are there. The most important thing that spirituality helps you, it tells you to build values. So once your values are intact, you can be able to use your values effectively in doing your business. There are a lot of people that have very wrong values in doing business. And then what happens is that they actually do things that are wrong. Because of money, you are ready to kill somebody. Because of money, you are ready to cheat on that person. Those are wrong values. But when you are able to ground yourself in faith, especially in your belief, you will always find out that every time you want to succeed, especially in those kind of things, you have to do good to another man. Doing good to other people helps you build, faith and capacity to do the things you need to do. So that's one of the points. That's one of the what spirituality in business does. Spirituality helps you to know what God's values are in business. And if you stick to it, you'll go a long way to making it better for you. Another area of concern, another thing of that is to understand what are the individual principles. A lot of people are very lazy and they use spirituality to cover it. And I'll tell you a case in point. A lot of people believe that yes, God answers prayers. And yes, God answers prayers. But a lot of them do not like the part where it says you need to walk. A lot of people don't like to walk when it comes to, you know, spirituality. They believe that after they've asked God, God should just pour the money down on them. No, that's not how God works. God expects you to go and farm. God expects you to go and plant. God expects you to go and walk. He blesses the works of your hands. Whether you're Christian, Muslim, or whatever faith, He blesses the works of your hand. If you don't have anything that you are doing, God has nothing to bless. So you need to put that in perspective and increase your work so that God has things to increase. And I tell people that there are four rivers that water the Garden of Eden in the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 10. Guess what happens? If God needed four rivers, you must have at least a minimum of four sources of income. You must have that. And put that. So that's what it does. Now, the positive effects and negative effects of relationship, especially when it comes to business, please note that you are always an average of four of your friends. Now, take for example that all your friends are failure minded. Even if you are success minded, there are two things that can happen. It's either you pull them up or they drag you down. But what is likely to happen is that they will drag you down. So you are the one to make a choice. Do you want your friends or do you want to succeed? So if you want to succeed, there's a likelihood that you will cease from that relationship. And that could always bring bitterness and everything. Please don't get blackmailed by your friends who will tell you that now because you have made money, you paid a price to do it. You will lose friends along the way and you will make some more friends. So you need to know, are these people working for you or working against you? Is the relationship working for you or working against you? You will have friends who will see that you're working, and the next thing that they do is that they come and they tell you, look, please, can I have some money? I want to start something. Meanwhile, they are not putting any effort. Meanwhile, they cannot repay you back that money. And if you try to get your money back from them, they will now begin to come against you that you're not being fair to them, you're not being nice to them or anything. When you were working for the money, they did not know. So when you, and I tell people, say, don't borrow your friend money. Don't borrow your friend money. If your friend asks for money and you want to be there for him, give him the money and let him go. Because if you ever put your mind that you want to borrow money from your friend and your friend wants to borrow money from you and he doesn't pay you, then you are in trouble. He doesn't pay you and that you have lost that friend. So what happens is that when you borrow money to your friends, that relationship is not going to go well. Trust me. It's either he doesn't return the money or if he returns the money, he will wonder why you're taking interest or why you're taking the money back in the first place. After all, your money is his or her money. So you need to be very careful about that. So be very careful about that. Money and friendship really doesn't work. Trust me. So, but if you have same values, you can do that, uncle. And if he understands that you're not borrowing him money for anything, it can be a challenge. It can be something to look at.
Good evening, sir. I am Beruli Naphtali Wilsi from Cameroon. I have been following your work for a while. That's how I came to know about this session of Ask Ubong King. So I come before you asking if it's possible for me to be one of your mentees and what it takes. I am really willing and available and wish all it demands will be within my reach. Thank you, sir.
Hello, Beverly. How are you doing? And first of all, thank you for reaching out to me. Beverly from Cameroon, so let me say bonsoir or bonjour to you. Let me say Dako for sending me the video. Now, what a mentor does to a mentee. Mentorship is wisdom without the pain. Now, a mentor is somebody that helps you, you know, fast track what you need to get, where you need to get to. A mentor feeds on the questions you ask. A mentor is somebody who answers the questions. to be my mentee, you get into my space when you ask the right questions. When you start asking the right questions, it tells me what you are learning. It tells me what you are studying. It tells me how far your mind has gone. You don't just be a mentee by just saying, okay, I want to be your mentee, so be it. No. What happens is that you decide. You go and go through the YouTube channel, and then watch the videos, then ask your questions. When you begin to ask your questions, it will tell me what you are listening. It will tell me what your challenge is. It will tell me what I can do for you. Then from there, it becomes an easy ride. But if you don't watch the videos, you will never understand my mindset. If you don't understand my mindset, you will not know the kind of questions to ask. Because anytime you speak, it reveals your mindset. Every time you talk, it reveals where you are. So once you begin to talk and tell me, I know the videos you watched, and I know what you're struggling with, and then I can be in a good position to respond to you. Now, once you do this over time, you begin to see that our relationship will increase every single time. Our relationship will move from one level to the other, and then it becomes better for each of us to understand that this is where we are, this is where the relationship has gone to, and how to take it. Anybody can be a mentee, but you need to keep on, you know, stay connected. I tell people that desire, stay connected, stay connected. When you are connected, you will be the one to find the place. And I wish you the very best. I'm looking forward to meeting you in person. I salute you. Have a fantastic day in Cameroon and enjoy, you know, like my... But make sure you don't finish all the jus de pomme. Don't finish it. Don't finish all the jus de pomme, you know. Au revoir.